Now, one thing. Lily, are you out there? You were here earlier. I saw. Is Lily out there? If not, Susan. Oh, there you are, Lily. Wave the hand around really much. Take a look at Lily. Make sure you contact her if you want to be a part of God's Closet this Sunday at Sunland Tonga. Remember that. And the reason why, by the way, I did the announcement now is because I want to make sure that we get this in the sermon. God's Closet is happening on the 15th, right? The 15th of August. If you are in need, connect with Lily, connect with Sunland Tahanga there on that Sunday. But if you are a volunteer and want to help, please come and help out either this Sunday or schedule the next one so you can be there, but you have a job at that point. Anyway, to do that is as a volunteer. So it's wonderful to be here, and today it is time for Abraham's. Does anyone know what the sermon is? Abraham's adjustment. I don't know. Say adjustment. You ever see the Adjustment Bureau? Anybody? That's a few years ago. Interesting plot. Really amazing, actually. An idea that there's a group, whenever I watch films, I always see that it's biblical in some way. I say, well, that's like this. This is, who's Jesus? Who's, you know, I start putting the different things, because I always think theologically, right? And I'm watching and I'm like, interesting, dealing with personal will, free will, versus control is what the film is about. And I was looking and I discovered, as I was watching it, I said, you know what? There was a biblical figure who the Adjustment Bureau worked with. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Jesus, Lord, we thank you. We love you and we praise you, and we ask for each person here to be with us as we discover the adjustments in our own lives that must be made to make an impact for you. In your name, amen. Again, before I get going, Spanish, if you need Spanish translation, let them know in the back. And also, I think those have to be nearer to this area on this side, because Zimri's on this side translating. So, turn with me in your Bibles. Do you have your Bibles here? Raise them up if you got them. Here, we'll get Algeson's camera over here. You got your Bibles here? Got your Bibles? Bring it with you when you come to church, or you can do it this way, right? Either way. The only problem with this guy here is as you're going through it, you never know if it's going to change on you, right? People can change text very quickly online. So let's get into our Bibles. In Genesis, we're going to go to chapter 22. It's the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 22. And we come to a circumstance, and before I start reading, I'm not going to make you to go to the other texts, but over in Genesis chapter 12, God called Abraham. He said, I will show you a land, or go to a land that I will show you. So Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, we're told, in the book of Galatians, it says that. And he followed. Does that mean Abraham was perfect? The word credited, does that mean, like, if you don't have any money and you're credited $1 million, is that your money? No, it means it's been given to you. So he didn't have righteousness on his own. Newsflash, imperfect people follow God, right? Now, can imperfect people get into heaven? Well, that's why the book of Galatians exists, because God credits us. He makes a choice. That's what the death of Jesus was about. But today, we want to talk, or should I say, I'm going to be bringing you a message a little less about credit and a little more about change. Because sometimes we say, wait a minute, well, if God saves me, I don't have to do nothing. I'm just fine the way I am. I can keep beating my dog. I can keep beating my wife. Sorry, I'm online. Oh, just kidding. I'm playing someone else, I promise you. But I can keep doing anything I want to do because that's who I am.
accept me the way I am.
Abraham followed Jesus. He went on to Egypt. And the first thing he does when he's worried about Pharaoh killing him and stealing his wife is, this is my sister. Wow. So Sarah's like, wow, I got thrown under the bus, right? She goes all the way to Pharaoh's house. But interestingly enough, what God does is he sends a plague. Actually, in the Hebrew, it literally says God struck Pharaoh with to strike, like to take a reed and go smack. He gave him a problem. And Pharaoh starts preaching to then Abraham when he finds out that the woman that's in his house that he took to be his wife, I'm sure it didn't, you know, they got hit with it pretty hard quickly, I'm hoping anyway. But the thing is he gets a vision or a dream that says, what you doing with this man's wife? I blessed Abraham. Stop messing with his wife. Stop having his wife. And Pharaoh starts preaching then to Abraham, says, why did you lie to me and say this is your sister? And Abraham's like, I. You know what? We can be holy people on the outside. We can do everything God wants where everyone sees it. But sometimes we don't make choices in our lives. Are you with me? Where no one really notices it until it becomes a big situation. Right? It's like, oh, this little sin, it's not a big deal. So I'm one of these guys that like drinks on the side, you know? Drinks on the side. I'm a pastor and I just drink. I don't, by the way. I promise you. But let's just say I'm just like sneaking it off until somebody sees me, snaps a picture, and puts it on the website. Hey, great job, Pastor John. You're doing Jack Daniels. You know, that's how it is. The secret things in our lives become the big things. That's why Jesus said clean the inside out first. Worry about your own backyard first before you start worrying about everybody else. This is the problem with this. I'm gonna be real open here real quick. You know, it's very politically correct now. You have to say certain things in certain ways. You gotta call this person this and call that person that, and you can't say what you just normally, you have to think about every word. The interesting thing about that is that's about the outside. It's not about the inside. You can be just the biggest racist on the planet, but as long as your words fit, oh, it's all good. Jesus doesn't care as much about the outside. He wants to change this. And when this changes, then it will flow out. And maybe your mouth might say wrong things, but it doesn't come from a bad place. See, that's the problem. We always worry about the outside, not the inside. And Abraham was the same. In fact, Abraham, from that very situation there in Egypt, his wife took on a handmaiden, and her name was Hagar. Remember this story? And his wife said, Sarah said, you know, I can't bear any children for you, so why don't you take on my handmaiden, Hagar? She can give birth for me, and it will be my child. That's how the ancient cultures worked. It's kind of like in today, you know, you have artificial insemination. Back then, you didn't have that. That was how they did it, legally. And so Abraham goes, oh, okay, good idea. Right? It's kind of like Solomon, you know, when you have 700 wives, you know, you think you're going to have more peace. No, it's not going to work like that. It just doesn't work like that. You know, I've got one wife, she's Anna, and I love her, and I stay with Anna. That's how it works. Happiness, we always think we know happiness until it gets complicado. And when it's complicado, it's no longer, then you got to change back, and it's hard to start from scratch. Abraham messed up again, and God's like, oh, God goes like this. You know that thing, I think, Lucky, are you out there? Lucky, you say, there you are, Lucky. You send me that video that was like this. It's like, Abraham, do I have now the mark of the beast on my forehead? All right, anyway, but the thing is, God then did something. Chapter 22 of Genesis. Isaac was born from Sarah. Hagar, the child, had been sent away. Hagar and Ishmael had been sent away. God still loves them. In fact, 12 princes come from Ishmael. In fact, the entire Middle East issues, and by the way, worldwide issues, come from the dysfunction between the two brothers, Isaac and Ishmael, fighting. To this day, we have that Palestinian-Israeli. We have that argument that constantly happens. But it doesn't mean God doesn't love Ishmael and doesn't bless Ishmael. He also blesses Isaac. Isaac, the child, now is getting older. And in chapter 22, it says in verse 1, sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham. And Abraham says, here I am. Then God said, well, let me stop. I want you to watch with me. This is from the film Abraham. And do the two-shot, James. Do the two-shot, James. We are going to do a test out right now. We're going to see if YouTube allows me to use this with fair use. I'm using the correct positives, but let's watch this together and hear what is said. Raise the volume up, and I'll keep commenting. Keep me down here, though, commenting so that YouTube is happy with me. This is from the film Abraham, made maybe 92, 93. He just put his son Isaac to bed.
Here I am, Lord. Take your son Isaac and go to the land of Moriah, to a mountain there which I will show you.
Can you hear it?
Offer him as a burnt sacrifice.
If you're Abraham, would you like what you just heard? Say what?
Offer him as a burnt sacrifice.
The ancient world used burnt sacrifices. It was a heinous thing. You take your child, you kill him and put him on an altar to cover your sins. Everything I ever heard about God,
my Lord,
has just changed.
Oh, my Lord! Why?
Richard Harris, who was a great loss in Hollywood when he passed away, incredible actor, he said, why? Now, of course, it doesn't have it in the text, what was just said there. But now we move on. Offer, take your son, your only son, which you love. Christopher, go ahead and turn down the pot on that computer. Thank you. And which you love, and go to Mount Moriah. You know where Mount Moriah is? When you go to Israel, whenever we do that, we are able to see it over the top. But I one time was able to go in to the Dome of the Rock, and you go down to the deepest place. You go under to the place, the original stone, where it is believed, where the Muslims believe and the Jews believe that he sacrificed his son. Now, you will say, wait a minute, he didn't sacrifice his son. but he did. Let's continue on. Your one and only son, there as a burnt offering on the mountain that I will show you. Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded up his donkey and took the two servants and his son Isaac. You know why he got up early in the morning? You know why? Why? Maybe, yeah, well, you know, just to say it, he didn't tell his son, though, Giancarlo. He didn't tell his son. Who is it would have stopped him if she knew what was going on? Sarah's like, yeah, you can try to go sacrifice him, but you ain't gonna do, not through me. You know how it is. Who runs the house? I mean, I know patriarchal culture, whatever, but who really runs the house? Seriously. It's like, okay, Abraham says, well, God, maybe, he was wise. He did it early in the morning. He began the trek. Now, many of you, as you're reading this or listening to it, you say, wow, what a heartless human being. Turn with me to Hebrews before we continue on. Hebrews chapter 11, the faith chapter. Hebrews chapter 11, and I believe it's going to be verse 17 where we will begin.
All right.
Is it 17? Ah, yes, it is 17. It says here, Paul writes, by faith Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises was about to sacrifice his one and what? Do you know the word? Here, monogenes in Greek, the word monogenes, one and only, monogenes, is the same word used for God so loved the world that he gave his monogenes, one and only son. Same word. Even though God had said to Abraham, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. Abraham reasoned that God could raise his son from what? Now, take it, because I don't want you to get ahead of the story. We'll go back to Genesis. Parents, brothers, sisters, imagine if you had to give up your one and only brother or sister or son or daughter. Abraham had lived his life in holiness, walking in the ways of God, doing his best for God so that everyone could see. Yeah, sometimes he made mistakes like the Hagar thing, and it became a big deal, but you know, sweep it under the rug, send him away, we'll figure it out. Isn't it great that God figures it out way better than we do? I'm not putting down Abraham. Abraham is you and me. Abraham is through whom Jesus came. He is so important, but it doesn't make him God. He's Abraham. Just like you and me. He makes mistakes, just like you and me. He sweeps things under the carpet, like sometimes you and I do. He makes errors. But does that mean he's bad? Well, we all have issues with that. But God is able to change us. I'm looking at the time. Let's continue on. God, though, wants us to change. Do you have things in your life that you sweep under the rug sometimes? Sometimes things that you do and you don't like. Or maybe you do like them, I don't know. Things that are affecting you. Maybe it's time for an adjustment. We oftentimes, when we talk about adjusting our own lives, we think about fear, because we don't really want to let go of the past, even though we hate our past at times, but yet we can't let go. It's the things that we are the most addicted to are the things we dislike the most. But until it's time to mess up and fall off the wagon, so to say. God said, sacrifice your one and only son. And Abraham said, you know what? If I do this, maybe God will raise him from the dead. And hopefully Isaac will still like me after he's raised. Imagine that as an old man. He takes his son. What amazes me even more is, I'm gonna now paraphrase here rather than read directly from the text. Isaac comes along and says, where's the sacrifice? Where's the sacrifice? He's got wood, he's got fire, where's the lamb? And you know what Abraham says? God will provide. Ooh, it's kind of like at the toy store when JD, when he was young, and he says, can I have this toy? And you know what I would say? We'll see. And later James told actually one of his friends what we'll see means. It means no. God will provide is the scary set of words that child hears. But he's not thinking about that. The two servants are left behind. You know why the servants were left behind at Mount Moriah? Because the servants will say, is this guy going senile? He takes that boy, Isaac, maybe 12, 13, maybe 14, maybe older. I don't know. Probably muscular, because when you're out and when you're working for a living, hunting and all that, you know, he could fight his dad off, I'm sure. Abraham begins to take the knife and tie his own son up. Wow. Pastor, where is this going? And then Abraham set the wood up. Okay, let me read here. I think it's in verse 7. When they reached the place that God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He then bound up his son and laid him down on the altar. This child, I'm sure, could have run from him. On top of the wood, then he reached out his hand and took the, what? The knife to slay his son. As he raises his hand above to I don't know, how do you do this to your child? If you love your child, how do you do it? As his hand began to move, his hand was seized by an angel of the Lord. Stop, the angel said. Stop. The Lord called out, Abraham, I am here, Abraham says. Do not lay your hand on the boy. He said, do not do anything to him. Now I know that you, now the word fear is here, but the word respect or understand or care about God is probably a good translation as well. You see, electricity, I fear electricity. When you have wires sticking out of the wall, do you want to put your hand on it? Why? Because you've been shocked before, right? But I love electricity. It allows us to have lights. It allows us to have all these good things, even electricity here. We're able to use these things. But I fear it. I respect it. If I understand it and how to work with it, it makes sense. I know, God says, you understand me. You respect me. You will do as I ask you. Because you have not withheld from me your son, your one and only son. Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket, he saw a what? A ram. His horns were caught inside that thicket. It's kind of like, you know, the animal where it's stuck, but that animal wasn't there before. He unties Isaac. Though the ram, you know, you don't want to kill a cute lamb, but yet, that was the way in the ancient world, that you show the love for God, that you're willing to give something of your own. And so, in essence, as in the book of Hebrews again, back into Hebrews chapter 11, it says in verse 19, I believe, yes, verse 19, Abraham reasoned that God would raise his son from the dead. So in a matter of speaking, he actually did receive him back from the dead. In other words, what God did is just like with Jesus and us. He swapped. The great swap happened. Jesus is dying on a cross. He doesn't deserve to die. We deserve to die. He swaps his death for us so that we might have life. The life that we did not deserve, we receive. The death he did not deserve, he receives. And he swaps it for us, just like that ram with Isaac. The big swap. So he did sacrifice his son, in, as Paul says, in a manner of speaking. From a certain point of view, right? My friends, do you have things in your lives that you need to fix? Because God wishes to make adjustments in your life as well. But so many times when we need to make adjustments, we want the easy way out. It means I can follow God and I can do it, but I don't need to deal with the issues that I have, right? We sometimes feel like that. I don't need to deal with those issues, right? Sometimes we feel like that. But you and I have issues that God wants to deal with, and he wishes to adjust. Not because he doesn't love you, but because he needs you, and you need him to make that adjustment in your life. But you know who it takes? It takes God and you. Pastor John is fine. He can tell you everything in the world. He can talk till he's blue in the face. He can drive you nuts. But it will never change you. The only way changes are made is between the Lord God and yourself. Are there things that you need adjustments on just like Abraham? Sometimes it means giving up things that we love. But I want to promise you, the only way you will have life rendered to you, rendered for you, made for you, sometimes by giving up a few of those things that you love so dearly. It's funny because as a pastor even, we deal with this. In church, you always know this. Sometimes a negative is a positive. You know? So when someone transfers out, sometimes you go, oh man, we lost. Well, sometimes it can be good. Sometimes it can be bad. But in the end, if the person is receiving something somewhere else, I'm good with that. That means it's a positive for them too. And that means it's a positive for everybody. Sometimes the thing you think you're going to miss so much maybe isn't really as important as you think. I'm reminded of friends of mine that are in other churches that have given up smoking. It is hard, especially when you got that routine, right? It is hard to give up things that you're addicted to, all of us. It's always hard. But then, interestingly enough, I'd have people say later on, after those different programs and they're starting to do it, they go, Pastor, I didn't know I had so much money in my account. It's like, yes, you're not paying what, in those days it was like $5 a pack, right? Today it's getting worse now. And doing two packs a day sometimes can really, it mounts up. My friends, I'm telling you, sometimes the loss isn't the loss. I'm not saying Isaac was worth losing, because God had a plan. He wanted Abraham to be the father of the faithful. And faithfulness is not just about believing, but it's about action, right? Are you with me on that? I want you to discover a joyful adjustment in your life that might give you purpose, meaning, and a new life. May God bless you all.
Thank you. bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for the example of Abraham, the adjustments he had to make to eventually turn him into the father of faith, to have complete trust in you, that he will sacrifice his own son. Lord, help us to make adjustments in our own lives, that we may have that same faith, that same trust, that same relationship with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, and you got a last song, right? No, you. Never mind. I'll do the goodbye for Streams of Life. Let me see, which camera we got here? Doing this one? All right, very good. I'm going to come on down. It's wonderful that you're here for Streams of Life. Keep coming back. Smash that like button. May God bless you all. May the joy that flows from the cross of Jesus Christ infest your life and bring you peace and a future. Thank you so much. Have a happy Sabbath. God bless. Thank you. Bye-bye now.